It's really hard to believe how much attention NIO has received since I first covered it back in mid-July of last year. The stock price absolutely soared from around $13 a share to $38 a share. And while it's no secret that we saw big dips in many EV stocks fairly recently, almost all of them are still trading at many multiples of where they were just a few years ago. In fact, if we look at the one-year charts, you have to realize that you could have picked up NIO at around $3 a share. So while there is a dip, it's certainly not the end of the world, especially when you consider the long-term goals of many of these EV companies. Really, anyone who bought in at these lower prices has made a lot of money and is on track for long-term growth. But what is NIO? What do they do and what makes them so special? Why has their stock 10x'd in a single year? NIO is an electric vehicle manufacturer that has gotten a lot done. In fact, just recently they delivered their 100,000th vehicle. Elon Musk even gave them a welcoming tweet, a congratulations. And he's certainly no stranger to the difficulties of ramping up production of an EV manufacturing line. So it means a lot. And it's certainly pretty significant, especially when you consider there's tons of these companies trying to get into the green vehicle space and the electric vehicle space that have yet to build a factory or a single vehicle for sale. We see so many companies jumping in trying to go public via a SPAC when they haven't sold anything other than stock. And really, that's one of the things that makes NIO pretty unique. It's one of the few companies to actually be producing and selling electric vehicles at a fairly high volume now. With all these SPAC startups and other companies promising the world, it is pretty impressive to see NIO's incredible growth year over year. In a year, we've seen their deliveries go up 121%. Across the board, we've seen triple-digit increases, percentage-wise. So many companies love to make promises, but NIO is actually delivering and selling vehicles. However, there are a few caveats that go along with that, but let's actually delve into their products. NIO actually started off in the SUV space, releasing two SUV models, the ES6 as well as the ES9. And technically, there were some other specialty products they offered, but those were not mass market vehicles. And honestly, that's a really genius idea because when we look at international SUV sales, SUVs have just been dominating the international market and especially the US market. China has seen a huge love for SUVs as of late, especially amongst the developing middle and upper class that continues to expand in the country. Really, it's a very clever market to get in if you are starting in the vehicle space. Luxury SUVs are a very high margin product with a very high demand. If you are trying to build a company from the ground up, it really does make sense to target this market. When it comes to ultra cheap vehicles, those require massive economies of scale, which simply isn't possible if you're a startup type company. So targeting the SUV market, and especially the luxury SUV market where the margins are even higher, is really a clever way of approaching this. This top-down approach is the same approach that Tesla took. And there are a lot of these small EV startups that are trying to begin with these small, ultra-cheap vehicles. And while it's not impossible to be profitable off a product like that, really they just don't have the assets to make them incredibly cheap, and it's a very limited and competitive market. When we look at these EV success companies like Tesla, we look at them beginning with these luxury products and then slowly moving down the chain as their manufacturing and engineering matures. Recently, they've also introduced the EC6, which is a lighter SUV. It's more in the crossover sportback area. And again, a compelling product that is slowly expanding in this huge SUV market. They are trying to capture all of the available customers they can get in that large chunk of the market. And of course, as you've seen in that intro video, their latest vehicle is the ET7, a sedan that's supposed to feature some pretty impressive autonomous vehicle technology. So that's one of the things that put them on the radar for a lot of investors. They have consistently been expanding their lineup and expanding their deliveries. Management has been very tactical about how they approach these problems and how they approach the market. And there's also a lot suggesting that they want to move to markets outside of China as well, because currently they're only selling within China. A simple look at their job openings shows that they do have multiple positions in the US as well as Europe. And these aren't completely brand new. They've had buildings and locations within the US and Europe for a while now, but they just continue to expand their divisions over in those respective territories. So what is the future of this stock? What is it going to be like in the long term? Well, every passing day, it becomes more and more apparent that we are moving towards an electric vehicle future. Pollution standards are just getting stricter and stricter. Government incentives for electric vehicles have just become more and more intense, especially in the Western world as of late. And charging infrastructure and electric vehicle designs have simply improved dramatically. While not currently competitive with internal combustion vehicles of a similar class, it is important to realize that electric vehicles in many ways are far simpler. They don't have to deal with a transmission or motor, nor do they have the extreme maintenance wear items and maintenance costs that internal combustion cars have, such as oil, other fluids, brakes especially, since manual vehicles haven't been popular for a while, so you can't really make use of engine braking, while electric vehicles can do one-pedal driving and regenerate a lot of that energy. Now, of course, things like gasoline costs are also fairly intense. As of right now, they're not too bad, but that could change pretty dramatically. And I would not be surprised if within 10 years, we see a point where electric vehicles are far cheaper than internal combustion vehicles. Also, if you like this sort of content, I would highly appreciate it if you like the video and subscribe to the channel. If you want to get constant notifications whenever I release a new video, just click the little bell icon. If you want two free stocks just for opening a brokerage trading account, I have a referral link in the description below to Webull. I'll have more details at the very end of the video. I deeply appreciate your viewership, so thank you. Another thing to consider is that many electric vehicles like Tesla's also feature certain technologies that just aren't present in any ICE vehicles you can purchase right now. Full self-driving being one of the more dramatic ones. The beta has shown staggering progress and very impressive navigation of difficult intersections and roads. Elon seems very optimistic, and the updates keep coming. If this is released to the public this year, it will absolutely be a game changer. Now, obviously, there are laws, restrictions, and other controls. I won't expect you to be able to legally sleep at the wheel, but if it is a perfect self-driving program, then it is going to change things very dramatically. U.S. states are regulated much differently than countries around the world, and I would not be surprised if in 3 to 4 years that we see states legalize things like robo-taxis and other technologies, especially considering many locations like Austin, Texas, are trying to become the new tech hub of the United States. And of course, there's already a huge demand for a technology like this. The current self-driving, while not as good as the betas, is pretty fantastic for highway driving. And road trips in a Tesla are particularly enjoyable because you actually get to take in the scenery and enjoy things. You're not constantly high-strung, staring at every single window, making sure everything is perfectly fine. The car takes care of a lot of that for you, and you just need to intervene when appropriate. With the progress we've seen, I would not be surprised if we have a proper full self-driving within 2 to 3 years from Tesla. You might have some technical legal requirements and things like that, but for all practical purposes, the car is completely driving itself, and you never really need to intervene. This is going to be an important technology that is going to reshape the world, and any manufacturer getting into the vehicle space, at least mainstream vehicle space, and especially the electric vehicle space, is going to have some sort of autonomous driving technology. This isn't something they can sleep on, since it takes so many resources to actually fabricate and create an effective solution. In January, we had NIO Day, where NIO launched its first autonomous driving vehicle, the ET7. There's a lot of details that go through this, and the vehicle does have a pretty impressive sensor package. It has multiple sensing units, multiple cameras, ultra-long-range LiDAR, 5mm wave radars, 12 ultrasonic sensors, 2 high-precision positioning sensors, and a pretty strong NVIDIA system on chip. Partnering with NVIDIA is probably a pretty wise move, but this is certainly a much different approach than Tesla, which is really focused on computer vision, to the point that Elon is trying to completely get rid of the radar sensors they currently have in the vehicles. I do actually think this is a little concerning. All these sensors likely make this vehicle incredibly expensive, so it's not going to be appropriate for a mass market autonomous vehicle. We also haven't seen the software. We don't have these beta testers posting videos like we do with Tesla. But then again, Tesla is very ahead of the curve. And it's important that NIO is not resting on their laurels. They are actually trying to do something. And right now, they might be throwing things at the wall and seeing what sticks. But I think it is very important that they are, in fact, doing something. It's important they're partnering with companies, and even if this isn't an ideal solution, something primitive is better than nothing, especially if they can iteratively improve it through over-the-air software updates. Right now, we just have very pretty renderings, but there is an emphasis placed on working with Qualcomm and NVIDIA. Now, let's actually talk about NIO's charging infrastructure and charging tools, because if you can't charge your electric vehicle, it's not particularly useful. NIO has multiple approaches that are pretty interesting. They have different types of home power plugs. They have a power map, which is pretty important for planning out road trips. They have their power chargers, which are like superchargers for Tesla spread out throughout China. They have a power delivery service. And perhaps one of the weirdest things they're doing is they have a battery swap station. Let's take a look at NIO Power Home first. They have two different home units, a 7 kilowatt model and a 20 kilowatt model. With a 100 kilowatt hour battery, the 20 kilowatt home plus will charge in around 3.5 hours and the 7 kilowatt will do 10 hours. For a 70 kilowatt battery, we can see 2.5 and 7 hours respectively. Honestly, that's pretty reasonable because especially when you're at home, you are probably just charging after a commute or something else like that. I find it more than likely that most people will be able to get away with the 7 kilowatt power home charger. So it's very important that both of these are available at different types of powers, because it's also going to depend on what sort of electrical wiring you have in your home. Now, here's where we get to the things that are kind of strange. The battery swap stations. NIO has some interesting things that you can do with your vehicle. You can make it so you don't actually own the battery in your vehicle, you lease it instead. And if you are on a road trip or you are planning to take a long road trip and you have a smaller battery, you can go to one of these power swap stations and it will automatically swap out the batteries for you. You can switch to a higher capacity one, or if you're just at zero on your battery, rather than waiting and charging for a while, you can take a battery swap in just 3 minutes. Realistically, the current situation for battery production is not looking particularly good for EVs in the future. There needs to be a dramatic upscale. And we saw during Tesla's battery day, they were making tons and tons of efforts to make sure that their mining partners are extracting as much of these important raw materials as they can get their hands on. With all these companies transitioning to electric vehicles, it is going to be a very demanding market for the raw materials. So it does sort of make sense to have these battery leasing options and other things, especially since batteries are so expensive. But then you have to consider the actual economics and speed of this battery swap. These are big, complex stations that take a lot of setup and a lot of dedication to build. In fact, they mention they have over 1,200 patented technologies just in one of these units. And if batteries are going to be your limiting factor for a vehicle, why would you have a station full of batteries doing absolutely nothing? Now, there is talk about how these batteries can be used to stabilize the grid, which makes sense as we adopt more green energies, which don't provide constant and controllable power like solar panels and wind turbines. You will need battery storage on the grid. It will be a necessity. The issue is, if a customer is coming here to get their battery swapped out, you can't really discharge the batteries in this station any significant amount. Because if they're coming in with 10% on their battery and they want to drive so-and-so miles, you can't just give them a battery with like 30% on it. That's going to be a waste of their time. It would have made more sense just to start charging. So it just does not make a lot of sense, because this is very expensive capital-wise, very intense engineering-wise. You can't really use the batteries in here for anything else if you're actually going to use them for battery swapping. And especially with these speed chargers, they're so slim, so small, and they charge very quickly. I was actually really scratching my head about this because I wasn't sure what they could be doing that would have this make any economic sense. But after some digging, I did find some very interesting information. China has pretty detailed subsidies for electric vehicles, and they actually recently reduced them a fair amount. However, China's subsidies typically apply only to vehicles priced under a specific amount, with a notable exception granted to vehicles built with battery swapping tech, a process that allows consumers to easily replace a car battery once it runs dead or needs an upgrade. So here is something that is rather interesting. NIO is making luxury vehicles, and many of them are going to be pretty highly priced. However, in order to still get those subsidies from the Chinese government, one of the ways they can get around this high price tag is to include battery swapping technology. So that does make sense as to why they're doing it. Tesla did, in fact, experiment with it. They had an automated battery swapping station, but they didn't think it was a very promising technology and instead focused on making their supercharger network larger and moving on to V2 and V3 supercharging. So I think a lot of this is really more a symptom of the weird subsidy structure in China rather than a particularly good forward model for electric vehicles in the future. But who knows? Some people might appreciate it a decent amount. In a couple years, we can see how much traction it gets and whether or not they continue to maintain or do anything with it once subsidies actually run out. Now we get to some fun things about NIO's power delivery services. Power Mobile is an interesting program they have where if you run out of juice, you can have a NIO van come to your car and have it charged up. So no need to worry about tow trucks or other things like that, especially if you're in a weird location that doesn't have any available chargers. It's all powered through an app, so it's just a single click to get an actual van to your location. And what's also pretty interesting is valet charging, which I think is absolutely fascinating. But I guess this is sort of a symptom of dealing with luxury electric vehicles. This might be the future where kind of like where you have gas stations where other people will fill up your car, they aren't self-service. You can also have valet charging stations for the rich in China. They have a lot of different benefits. They have a lifetime free out-of-town power service up to 12 times a year, multiple free power services, and a whole quota for the amount of kilowatts you can get per month. It's pretty detailed, so this is something that they have thought out extensively, which is very important. Again, an electric vehicle is nothing without a charging network, so the approaches that they take to the charging network and batteries is pretty fascinating, and I'm glad they're taking things like this seriously. This is probably one of the biggest hurdles, other than actually manufacturing the vehicles, that any EV company will have to deal with. Charging and power management, things like that. Now, I have had a lot of nice things to say about NIO. And in reality, they have done a lot of fantastic things. They are not some small company trying to go public with a SPAC that isn't selling anything other than stock. They've done a lot, which is impressive, and I respect that. But we do need to talk about the types of risks that are associated with a stock like this and any potential downsides they can have. You need to make an educated and informed decision whenever you are making a financial investment. The first and clearest problem that we see with NIO is mainly that they are not a profitable company. If we look at their earnings per share, we see that they have never actually been a profitable company. They have never made money. And that's an important thing to discuss because it means they have to change something about their business model. They have to do something different. They can't just stay the course and continue building up a war chest of cash. It also means that they are not accumulating cash each quarter. So what does a company do when they don't actually have any cash on hand and they need to pay for something, even just their standard expenses because they're spending more than they earn? Well, they do things like sell stock and other things like that. And that ends up diluting the shares of anyone who currently holds NIO stock. And NIO has actually done a couple share dilutions. They've done a couple to raise capital, which is important for developing the company, but it's important to realize that it also makes a stock rather volatile and maybe a bit risky if you're dealing with options. Now, I will say their dilutions have not been particularly insane. They're not selling off a comical amount of stock, but they're certainly noticeable, and they have had significant effects on the stock price in the short term, typically. And while it certainly does look like things are getting better for NIO, they have been improving when it comes to earnings, you still need to realize they are not yet profitable. A stock like this, however promising it is not the same as maybe some large ETF that you can hold with multiple companies. it is going to be a completely different type of risk. Another thing to consider is how large do you think NIO is going to be? Currently, they're sitting at $62.46 billion for their market cap. In comparison, General Motors is $86.68 billion, and Ford Motor Company is $49.93 billion in market cap. It's no question that EVs are going to be a big part of the future, but how long is EV adoption going to take? How severely will raw material supply and battery manufacturing limit us? NIO is sitting at a pretty high market cap, and if they can't grow at the exponential rate that their stock price has credited them, then you could be down on your investments when it comes to a year or two or three. How long are we going to wait for NIO to become a big player in the future? How many years are you willing to hold? And of course, you need to consider whenever you put money in a company, you have an opportunity cost associated with that. Would there be other EV stocks you would prefer to hold? Would there be other positions that you think would have a greater upside in the next 2 to 3 years? And they've certainly faced a decent amount of resistance. There are multiple investors that are huge EV bulls, and a lot of people are putting these EV stocks on buy saying that they will be the future. And many of them are very promising. Many of them are doing fantastic things. But we haven't seen the share price continue to climb. In fact, we saw that massive correction from their all-time highs, even as their fundamentals have improved. So what sort of plays are you going to deal with? If the timing on these stocks is even more difficult than the general market, would it make sense to deal with something like options, which could screw you if they happen to do a share dilution or if investors just decide to dump again? It's a difficult position to be in, and it's something to realize. These stocks are inherently volatile, and they're being stared at with a lens of growth. Whenever there is big concerns in the market, growth stocks are the first to go because people want to get into something safe. They've been doing fantastic. They have really been doing a good job on their share price as well as the fundamentals of the company. But you do need to keep in mind something like this is likely going to be far more volatile than many other cornerstone stocks that are in this $60 billion range. Again, at $62.46 billion, they aren't particularly small. So you need to account for how large you think they're going to be. Another massive concern is simply supply shortages. Fairly recently, NIO had to shut down their factory for 5 days due to the global chip shortage, and their stock took a hit because of that. The reality is there is a huge demand for high-performance microprocessors, and all of the fabrication space is being taken up by the big players. They are growing like crazy. And having actually worked in the manufacturing space, the cruel reality of supply and fabs and other things like that is that they kneel towards their biggest purchasers. I was working at a fairly large company, and we were ordering millions of dollars of parts. But ultimately, we were on the same list as Apple, who was ordering billions upon billions of dollars of parts. We were a small fish, and while we needed certain things, certain paperwork, other things like that, ultimately, those big suppliers did what Apple wanted, not what we wanted. And that's really just the nature of the beast. They are not just competing with other car manufacturers, they are competing with anyone who needs fab space. And NIO's cars are not these simple rheostat-controlled electric vehicles. They are complex, fancy, luxury vehicles with a lot of computational power that want to try to get into the autonomous space as well. They're going to need a lot of chips. They're going to need a lot of lithium. They're going to need a lot of things. And supply could definitely be a concern in the coming years. China has also been pretty aggressive with their subsidies, but they've rolled back some of them and modified others. We're seeing incredible adoption of EVs, but if the subsidy case changes in China dramatically, it could really change things around. You never really know what's going to happen when you deal with these large governments. The Chinese government is a tough nut to crack, and it does seem like they want to dominate the EV space, but you never know exactly. Another thing to consider is the type of bans that are going around. The corporate structure of Chinese corporations, especially large ones, is rather different than many other companies in the West. There is government involvement and certain government ownership. And when it came to things like 5G technologies and other emerging technologies in the telecom space, Huawei was banned in multiple countries, especially the US. there are a lot of concerns about Chinese government involvement and things like that. And when you have a high-tech car that is collecting a lot of sensor data that is in a market that the U.S. wants to try to dominate as well, it does bring concerns. There are a lot of politicians and other people in the West that are probably going to push back against NIO if they try to move over. And while we don't know for certain if they want to come over to the West, the fact that they are hiring people in Western nations, the fact they're listed on the New York Stock Exchange and have American investors, does really suggest that they are likely viewing that as their long-term goal. And when you consider a large international car corporation, if they want to continue expanding, they probably want to reach out to every single market they can touch. But again, there's been a lot of pushback against things like that. And there are tons of huge Chinese tech stocks that have threatened delisting before. And they've taken a hit because of that. U.S.-China relations and China-Western relations are complex, messy, and that's always something you need to consider when you have a Chinese company. If you're watching this video in English, I'm assuming you're probably from a Western nation, but you could be in China. There certainly are a lot of Chinese people, and I have a pretty mixed audience. But this is something to consider whenever you're investing in foreign companies, how your government is going to react, how different nations and territories and allies are going to react, and what exactly is going to happen. And things are a little weird for foreign companies because they can sort of avoid and get around certain requirements that are needed for U.S. companies. It's a little complex, and that's the topic of a different video, but it's something to consider. And while you might say Japanese vehicles and Korean vehicles, all these foreign brands sell cars in the U.S., some of those are imported, but there are tons and tons of domestic vehicle manufacturing plants in the U.S. Even when Tesla is selling vehicles in China, they have Tesla Shanghai. So without any sort of manufacturing space or factory in the United States or other Western nations, there is a potential concern that they could just be completely locked out. Companies like Toyota or Honda don't really worry about tariffs or anything because they make almost all of their vehicles in the United States, as well as many other brands. Overall, I think NIO is a seriously impressive company that has done a lot so far. They have a detailed lineup that has tactically approached the most popular market in the entire international community, as well as China. They are working towards autonomous vehicles, and they've had continued staggering growth year over year. Their management really does seem solid, and so many things about this company have really impressed me, especially when compared to its peers in the electric vehicle space. Granted, I just had a whole segment about possible concerns, and I think all of those are very reasonable and things to take into account. But overall, NIO has been an impressive display so far. Really, they've been a success story in the EV space, and they've been doing things every single year rather than pushing out ridiculous production deadlines after becoming public via a SPAC. There are certainly risks with NIO that don't exist for other companies, but overall, I've been extremely impressed with them. I think they're a solid company, and within the next few years, I expect them to be a big player in the electric vehicle space. If you're interested in investing in the market with self-directed trading, a fantastic way to start is with Webull. If you sign up now using my referral link in the description of this video, you'll get two free stocks valued up to $1,850. And these stocks are selected from companies like Facebook, Starbucks, Snap, Google, Procter, Gamble, and more. All the money in your account is yours to invest, trade, and withdraw as you please. There are zero fees associated with depositing money. You just get your stocks and you'll get your buying power immediately. So if you want a fantastic brokerage with mobile, desktop, and web trading, just use the link in the description below.